episode 37 of the BioBalance Healthcast, and I'm Dr. Kathy Maupin.
And I'm Brett Newcomb, and today we're talking about breast cancer. Cancer and cancer diagnosis, when people get a cancer diagnosis, it's important to understand that what that means is that there's a potential that you can die.
Right, but that can't be the overwhelming thought. Immediately, your emotions kick in. My patients come in and they have the deer in the headlights look.
Oh my God, yes.
And I'm not sure that they hear anything I say. So one of the important things is bring somebody with you, take notes, and you need to like bring a dictaphone or something so you can then go back and listen to what your doctor just said, because the fear will overwhelm you.
Yes.
But it's not something that you should think about with fear, because we have great rates.
We have good news.
Sure.
Absolutely.
We have great news.
We have good news about cancer. You know, it's treatable, it's curable, it's survivable more and more and more. And the statistics on that, we have some recent statistics we'll share with you today. They are really good. But we want to focus primarily on a discussion of a type of breast cancer, breast cancer, because it impacts women in such a devastating way, in part because there is the risk that it radically changes the way that they look, that the potential for breast surgery and breast removal, and that destroys their sense of their own femininity and their projection of themselves as a feminine woman. That is an additional frightening aspect of breast cancer that you don't always have with other kinds of cancers.
The thing I hear about the most is when patients come in and they say, I need chemo, I'm going to lose my hair. That's my greatest fear. And the other good news is we now don't always need chemo. We don't always need radiation. The surgeries are so complete, and they're good for reconstruction. They are made so that they can keep nipples in place, and you can have implants, and you don't look like you have cancer when it's over. Mm-hmm. And that's amazing, and that's new. We just got legislation probably 5 years ago in Missouri that states that insurers have to pay for reconstruction.
When you talk about that, and you talk about keeping nipples from breast removal and, mm-hmm. and reconstructed breasts, is there still sensitivity? Is there still that connection to feeling and arousal?
Actually, there usually isn't, but it's kind of like losing your belly button. You know, you just don't want to lose it.
So it's a psychological, cosmetic
right.
reality.
Right,
that
you don't want to look like something's
yes.
really happened. You don't want to be reminded every day when you look in the mirror mm-hmm. that you have cancer.
Right.
That's a very depressing fact. And, you know, if you think about that and dwell on it, then you're going to get depressed and you're going to not heal as well and not overcome it as well.
Well, and depression is a major consideration. One of the primary factors of treatment for a lethal diagnosis of any kind, including cancer, is having good mental health and being invested in getting well and in believing that you can get well and that you can do things to impact your chances of getting well. And so as we pursue this conversation today, part of what we want to talk about is what are the specific risks for getting breast cancer and for dying from breast cancer, and are any of those under your control, and are any of them not under your control? And then we want to also talk about risks of mortality issues from all causes and talk about where breast cancer falls in that ranking.
In general, women think that the highest incidence of cancer or any other disease mm-hmm. is breast cancer, and that their highest risk of dying is of breast cancer. But in truth, that's not the case. In terms of getting a cancer and dying of it, the highest risk is lung cancer, and you can prevent that in most people because you stop smoking or you stop allowing your partner to smoke. So that really does change the risk, but lung cancer is twice as likely to kill someone as breast cancer.
40.6 women with lung cancer out of 100,000 die, 24 women with breast cancer die.
And that's out of 100,000, just think
about that.
That's
out of 100,000, yes.
Now, the risk for an individual woman during her lifetime, and I think people think my risk is 8%, eight out of 100 this year. It's a risk for your whole lifetime. You have one in eight chance mm-hmm. of getting breast cancer in your entire lifetime. That could be when you're 90, right before something else gets you.
It's like men with prostate cancer. If you live long enough, prostate cancer will get you. So the challenge for men is to die before that happens.
Of something else.
Of something else,
and
that's
if we,
right.
And you know, when we look at risk, you have to also think, okay, let's put this in perspective. Risk of dying is second to lung cancer, mm-hmm. okay? But risk of dying of other things, it's in fourth or fifth place.
Breast cancer deaths are fourth or fifth place.
Cancer is fourth or fifth place in terms of dying of something else.
So when you are looking at the issue of hormone replacements, is this a good medical strategy for me as I age? What is the cost-benefit ratio of this kind of treatment for me? If I do well by receiving this treatment, how does that work? What does that do for me? And if I don't do well, I mean, you have to figure, what are the cost-benefit ratios?
And when the cost is the cost of your health,
not
the
dollar
cost in dollars.
Yes.
So the cost of your health, the cost to your family, the cost to your emotions.
Mm-hmm.
And in reality, you have risk factors you can change. You can't change your genetics. You can't change your race. You can't. These are all things that increase risk or decrease risk.
Well, and by genetics, you're talking about a compromised immune system, or you're talking about a gene trace that comes by having at least two other female relatives that have breast cancer.
I'm talking about more about the genetics, the BRCA1 and 2 gene, which mm-hmm. we don't know if we have unless we're tested, and we're mm-hmm. rarely tested. It's a very expensive test. So if we have BRCA1 or 2,
mm-hmm.
we are going to get breast cancer in our lifetime. 87 out of 100 women with BRCA1 or 2 will get breast cancer. So that is genetics. There's not much you can do to avoid it, but if you notice, 87% is not 100%. Not everyone gets breast cancer
and
who has those genes.
And if you get it, it's not 100% mortality rate.
No.
It's 24 in 100,000.
Yeah, our mortality rate has gone way down with mm-hmm. all the research. So it's not really a death sentence, and it's not really a loss of identity sentence anymore, because now they understand that we need to keep our bodies, we need to keep our hormones, hopefully,
mm-hmm.
and that's very, very important to women who have cancer. So we're really talking in this podcast about women who don't have cancer, who are afraid of getting cancer, and have the number one fear of getting cancer be taking hormones, which is really not true.
Well, we will continue our discussion about breast cancer in other podcasts, but we want to make sure that before we get to the close of this one, we talk about other lethality factors and issues that women have to make decisions about when they consider, should I get hormone replacement therapy? And so what are the other things that cause women to die in greater numbers than breast cancer?
Lung cancer.
Lung cancer, certainly. As a cancer. Mm-hmm.
And then we go to heart disease, which is number one, mm-hmm. stroke, diabetes, complications of diabetes, and those, and emphysema. And those are all fairly preventable if you change your lifestyle. And we're going to talk about risk factors and how to change them. And so you can decrease your risk of those deaths and breast cancer at the same time by making some changes in your life.
So that brings us back to the conversation about genetics as a factor, and then factors that you can control. And the factors that you can control that are common in all of these lethal high mortality illnesses are things like obesity, alcohol abuse, exercise, diet, smoking,
mm-hmm.
you know, lifestyle choices, lifestyle habits that are really difficult for people to deal with, but it is possible for you to do, and it's possible for you to do those things without major medical interventions.
I love it when someone comes in and they're a smoker and they smoke a pack a day and they drink 10 drinks a week and they sit down and they go, oh, I'm afraid to take estrogen. Well,
yeah.
first of all, they have two other factors that are going to cause them lots of trouble in terms of every cause of death.
Mm-hmm.
And if they would stop doing those things, which that's adjustable, they can stop doing that, and they will improve their risk of living a longer life and decrease their risk of getting any of those lethal illnesses. So estrogen doesn't cause increased mm-hmm. risk of breast cancer. We're going to talk about that in a later podcast. But the fact is that they have two other things that we talk about. And I try to decrease their risk by just changing lifestyle. It doesn't really cost you anything. In fact, it may save you money. So those are the things that really need to be addressed. Those are the risk factors.
And lifestyle and good decision making are important criteria for any treatment protocol or any treatment consideration. you have to realize that you have responsibility for the way that you live. You don't have responsibility for your genetic inheritance that comes to you full-blown as a gift from your parents and ancestors. But you have a responsibility for the way you choose to live your life. And as Kathy says, sometimes people don't want to talk about those things that they're addicted to or invested in or habituated to. They want to talk about, is there a magical pill? Is there a magical treatment? Can I just, you know, have surgery for that? Is there some quick and easy fix that doesn't require me to change my behavior or my mindset?
Yeah, they do. And there are a couple things that are genetic that you can adjust.
Okay.
One is that if you have a particular aromatase enzyme, which shouldn't be familiar to you, but it's an enzyme that makes...
It's not a phrase I hear every day.
makes testosterone into estrone, which is an estrogen. If you have an enzyme that makes a lot of estrone, and that's in your genetics, we have blocking agents to stop that, and we use it now to prevent cancer. One is a very natural supplement called DIM, diindol methane, and that stops that conversion of testosterone that you make into estrone, which is very stimulating to breast cancer. Not estradiol, estrone, old lady estrogen.
Old lady estrogen, yes. And you always make that distinction between estrone and estradiol.
Right, estradiol isn't a participant in causing breast cancer, but estrone is.
Well, let's talk a little bit more specifically about breast cancer.
Okay.
You had said to me at one point that by the time a woman is able to be diagnosed with breast cancer, she's already had those cancer cells for 7 years.
That's absolutely true. And one cell changes 7 years before we can ever see or feel or even image on a mammogram a breast cancer. So the problem happened 7 years beforehand. It's not because you started taking hormones last year. It's been going on, and that cell actually grows and grows and grows to a point where we can actually feel, see, or view it on an x-ray.
So early diagnosis is critical to survival rates and to good treatment rates. And so you have to do mammograms, you have to do self-exams, you have to be aware of your risk potential genetically, if you can be. I know that you don't take the tests that are so expensive, but you know your family history. Mm-hmm. So you are cautious and you are sensitive and you seek constant checks, regular checks.
Right, and we don't have an immunization like we do now for cervical cancer.
Mm-hmm.
Someday I hope we do. But we have no way of actually preventing breast cancer.
But the statistics about early diagnosis are astonishing.
That's our only defense.
Women that have breast cancer just in the breast have a 5-year survival rate of 98.6%.
And that's
so
that's
if it's
awesome.
Caught while it's just in your breast, your chances of living through it are really very, very good. If it spreads to your lymph node, it drops a little bit, drops to 83%, but it's still 83% survival rate after 5 years. If you don't catch it by then and it spreads to other parts of your body, then your survivability diminishes. The statistics on that are pretty astonishing.
I'm a believer in doing mammograms every year after 40 because...
Well, you know, they came out with a report 6 or 7 months ago that said, oh, you shouldn't do that every 2 years. That's a gross expenditure and a waste, and, you know, we need to recalibrate.
Well, that's money talking, but that's not health talking.
Okay.
Because most of the breast cancers that we find, and that we find early, are between 40 and 55. And so getting a mammogram every year is very important. That's how we see it. But I've also figured out and suggest to my patients that not only do you need a mammogram, you need an ultrasound. An ultrasound finds breast cancers that mammograms can't see.
Mm-hmm.
So because of that, you have to ask your doctor to write an order for an ultrasound of your breast and a mammogram. That will cover you. That means
so
they're going to catch all the cancers.
Over age 40, you should get that, what, every year?
Every year.
And you have to ask your doctor to write that prescription because they don't automatically do it.
They won't do the ultrasound unless you ask them.
Okay.
But you could ask the radiologist as well if you're self-referred. But it's very important to find 15% of the cancers.
Mm-hmm.
Mammograms don't find
15%. And to find
15%.
Them early, before they spread while your survivability is maximized.
So that's take home. You need your mammograms. You need to go to your doctor every year and be examined. You need an ultrasound, and early detection is the best way to ensure that you're going to live a long time without breast cancer going on and on.
So a breast cancer diagnosis, any cancer diagnosis, really scary, but also more and more survivable. So we're going to continue our conversation in a future podcast about breast cancer and other cancers. If you have questions or comments about this podcast, you can email us at podcast@biobalancehealth.com, or you can read my blog at brettnewcomb.com.
And if you'd like to know more about BioBalance Health or bioidentical hormones, visit our website, biobalancehealth.com, or call my office, 314-993-0963.